Good afternoon. And thanks for coming, because today is such a beautiful day out there for all of us lake people. But I think you will be very happy that you came today. As you're seeing the different pictures, and as I looked at the back and the pictures of these three young ladies, my goodness. And a lot of us have, I think we've missed one concert since 2010. But to see them grow up, mature, and a lot of us who ourselves played piano had the fear of, you know, with the ivories in contests or recitals, etc. But it's just been wonderful to watch them develop, has it not, over the years. And if you read the information on each one, but Emma has been, majoring in piano at the Manus School of Music, and she's heading there now to go to the Manhattan School of Music with a full ride scholarship, which is, when you look at everything she's accomplished. But have any of you been to Aspen in the summer and seen all the fabulous musical events that they have, including the Denver Symphony that goes in summers there? But she just spent the summer in Aspen, and it's a very prestigious place to go and actually be in the workshops to spend time there. And it's a wonderful place to be, not to mention being in the beautiful mountains. But she is going to then go into her master's in piano performance, and again with a full ride scholarship. So you can all be very proud. I feel proud that we've witnessed Emma's growth, and she was the first concert, and it to see her, and then here comes Jacob and all the rest of them now growing into being masterful pianists. Also, Cecilia starting seventh grade, and had honorable mention last year in the Minneapolis Music Teachers Mozart Concerto Competition. I can't say that more than one time without fumbling. But, that is quite a competition if you are from Minneapolis. And Sophie will be starting fourth grade, and she is performing this year as the grandstand at Labor Day at the Minnesota State Fair. And has won first place in the talent competition last year. So when you win that, you can't win it 2 years in a row. You have to wait for the following year to then compete again. We got to listen to them warm up. And I never played the piano, honestly. I never did. Listening to how wonderfully they all play the piano, it's absolutely astounding. And to have four in the same family be of this level of honor students, wonderful people individually, but also athletes. Now, Emma probably will brag on her track performances when she was going through junior high and high school, but did you know that Cecilia actually competed last year in Oregon in the national track in the sprints, and they both went and participated this year in the Junior Olympic Track and Field Championships in North Carolina. So when you put the athletic with the academic, and then you see the 4+ hours a day that these wonderfully talented musicians spend playing, and I can tell you, as hard as I practiced, no, it was never that level. And again, their memories, and you know what a wonderful thing music is to teaching all of us so many things. We want to thank the United Methodist Church, Pastor Lauren, for allowing us to be here. And I want to acknowledge this beautiful baby grand piano was donated in 2012 by Dr. Reverend Ed Poitras and his wife Janelle. And I think most of you know them. But it's a fantastic piano. It's the second piano Ed told me today that they donated to a church, the other one being somewhere in this country, and I can't remember where, but there is a second piano. Somewhere in the country. Jacob is not performing today, but I think we should all say, why not? And you saw him come in late, but I'm sure he can whip something off. But if you ever get onto Taggart Square to the webpage, you'll see Jacob performing with, and these two have performed all over the world. They have competed, Jacob and Emma, all over the world. They have also performed with symphonies. But in the last 3 years, I suppose, Jacob performed with the St. Paul Orchestra, the St. Cloud Orchestra, and the Mankato Orchestras. And the Grieg that he performed in St. Paul is amazing. So if you get online and just pull up Jacob and or Taggart Square, they do have their own webpage, but you'll get to tune in to a lot of their performances throughout the year. So it's a fun thing to kind of do. And Jacob now will be a freshman this year at Washington Lee, which is in, as you know, Virginia. And it's where VMI is also. Betsy and I have been there, and it's a beautiful area. And it's a top-notch college. And he also, both of them, Emma and Jacob, have full-ride scholarships, which I know Jared, who's in the back of the room, can wave, and that's the father, is very pleased that they got their full ride. And she's in piano performance, and Jacob is, am I correct, in business focus? And so, you know, you must be very proud parents. So instead of me up here talking any longer, and there will be an intermission, so you get to hear me speak one more time. Don't be disappointed. And so you have the agenda, the itinerary, or the program, whatever you'd like to call it. And let's give a warm round of applause of welcome to our prodigies.
Hello, I'm so glad that you're here today and you could make it to this wonderful concert. My name is Sophie and I'm 7 years old. And the first piece on the program that I'll be playing is the first movement of a Mozart concerto, number 23. Mozart wrote this concerto to play for himself in a concert. A concerto is a solo piece written to play with an orchestra. But we don't have an orchestra today, so Emma will be playing the orchestra parts on the piano. That's what I call the Taggart Philharmonic.
A fun little story about this concerto. Towards the end of his life, Mozart was the favorite composer of, you'll probably never guess, Joseph Stalin. And he used to listen to a lot of Mozart, and one night he heard a recording of the Russian concert pianist Maria Yudina playing this concerto on the radio. And he called up the radio station and he asked if he could have the recording. And what he didn't know was that it wasn't actually a recording and it was a live broadcast of a concert that was happening that evening. But you just don't tell Stalin, like, oh, we don't have a recording. So they called Maria Yudina up after the concert and they reassembled the orchestra that night. They recorded it immediately, and they sent it to him the next morning, and he had no idea. And he loved it so much that he paid Maria 20,000 rubles, and she wrote him a little letter back that said, you know, thank you for your great generosity, and I hope God forgives you for your great sins. And he was such in awe of her and her playing that she was never persecuted and she lived out a very long and happy life. The same really could not be said for Stalin because when he was found dead, the recording of Maria playing this concerto was found on his record player and it was the last thing he heard before he died. And now our Mozart concerto under less gruesome circumstances.
Thank you.
I remember playing that piece when I was a little bit younger, so it's very fun to see everything come full circle and to be able to play it with Sophie. The next piece that you're going to hear, we're moving from the classical era to the romantic with a piece by Frédéric Chopin that is one of my personal favorites, the Ballade No. 3. Chopin was the first composer to write ballades. He kind of coined the term, and he didn't really have much of a definition for it. They don't really have a set form or really an intended purpose. It's just kind of a large-scale work for a solo instrument. He did, however, borrow the term ballade from the term ballad, which is, as you might know, just a very long story that's usually sung. The ballades, he didn't really intend for them to have a specific story, and he kind of invites the listener to come up with their own story as they listen to the pieces. I feel like number three, he wrote a set of four ballades, and this one is the third. Number three is, I feel, the most visual. So as you listen to it, try to pick up on the really long melodic lines that he has throughout the entire piece. He was kind of known for writing these very long melodic lines, as you'll hear in this, and the nocturne, and the concerto later. So it's just a wonderful representation of his writing, and I hope you enjoy.
Up, down, up, down. Debussy was a French composer at the forefront of the impressionistic movement of music. The impressionistic movement of music created wide use of whole tone scales and lots of pedal that created new colors and textures that seemed to float across the bars of time. Gardens in the Rain is from a set of three pieces in which Debussy creates musical pictures from around the world, Japan, Spain, and France. This piece is a picture postcard of a windy, rainy day in France. The fast-moving 16th notes create images of falling rain, and the jumps and leaps make you wonder if there's lightning and thunder. But the flourish at the end, the most beautiful of all, makes me think this piece ends with a brilliant rainbow. Claude Debussy quotes two children's folk songs in here to add a childlike sense of awe and wonder.
Thank you.
Final piece before this intermission is, it's a very cool piece. I really love it. One of Rachmaninoff's most famous compositions was his C-sharp minor prelude, which you're not going to be hearing today, but you will be hearing a few measures of it at the beginning of this piece that you're going to hear. This is Hazel Scott's jazz arrangement of Rachmaninoff's C-sharp minor prelude. Hazel Scott was an African-American jazz pianist from the 1920s. She lived in New York. She was also a singer as well. She appeared in a few Broadway shows and tried a little bit of time in Hollywood. Didn't like it. Went back to New York. She really loved the jazz scene there, and she played in many of the famous jazz clubs. And this piece that you're about to hear was one of her signatures. I first heard it a couple of years ago at Carnegie Hall. It was played as an encore by an amazing concert pianist named Michelle Kahn. Fast forward to today, now this piece is one of my favorites to play, and I'm also going to be studying with Michelle Kahn starting this fall for grad school. So, it's kind of cool how it all works out. It is an incredibly fun arrangement. The reason that I've brought it here to share with you today is because I will be playing it at the State Fair in a couple of days for their talent competition, so you get to hear it first.
I cannot pass up an opportunity for a dress change.
Here we are.
You've been
has so many dresses, and then you only get to wear one per concert, and that just wasn't going to do it for me. So, you know. As many of you know, I just graduated college this past May. I've been out in New York for a few years, and I'll be out there again this fall for grad school, and probably will stay out there full time for as long as I have money to do so. But it's been a really incredible time. College was great, and New York is such an incredible place to network and make connections. I've met incredible people, a lot of my idols that I grew up listening to, which was really fun, just to see them in concert and be able to talk to them and have lessons with them and stuff. I was able to play at Carnegie Hall a couple of times, which was definitely a college highlight for me, and one other hall, Steinway Hall, that's out there as well. So yeah, it's just been a really fun time, but I really feel like no matter how many like big fancy halls are out there, it's always the most fun to me to come back here to Hubbard, because it's just, you all are like a second family to all of us, and we've known you for so long, and this place is very near and dear to our hearts. So thank you again for coming, and... Oh. we have a very exciting second half planned. I think Sophie is going to go ahead and start. Thank you.
The next piece on the program is Dizzy Fingers. Dizzy Fingers was written in 1923 by an American composer named Zez Confrey. It was originally written for a clarinet quartet. This piece was written in a ragtime style, and it's a fun, showy crowd pleaser. Thank you.
that is the piece that Sophie's going to be playing at the State Fair at the Grandstand on Labor Day. So I'm sure that is going to be a big hit. It's a very fun one. The next one is very different, night and day, very different style. We're back to Chopin. I think Chopin might be our favorite composer as a family, so you'll see, you know, a lot of him sprinkled in the program tonight. And I think Chopin's nocturnes are among some of his most intimate and personal works. They really explore his creativity, especially with those long melodic lines that I mentioned earlier. This nocturne specifically, when the melody is presented, it's usually presented, I'll give a little demonstration actually. Instead of just one note, he doubles it, so it's. And it's usually, this duet continues for most of the piece, which is specific to this nocturne mostly. And I really hear a lot of, it sounds like an operatic duet to me. I think of two sopranos like sharing the limelight or something. It's a very lovely piece indeed. And I first started working on it when I was much younger. And now I've just brought it back this summer, and I think it really speaks to how personal experience can shape the way that you interpret the piece, because the way that I looked at it when I was 13 or 14 is not the way that I'm looking at it now, so I just think it's very interesting. But yes, here's Chopin Nocturne in D-flat major.
Thank you.
Hello, welcome back to the Taggart Philharmonic. I will be playing the second and third movements of Chopin's F minor concerto. The second movement was inspired by Chopin's infatuation with a classmate of his at the Conservatory of Warsaw. He wrote to a friend of his, "It has been 6 months and I still haven't spoken to her." Although things might have not worked out with the soprano, we are still given the gift of this beautiful second movement, also called Adagio or Larghetto. The third movement is a lively and exhilarating piece. It begins with a melody in the style of mazurka, which is a Polish dance, and moves to a rustic theme, back to the mazurka again. And finally, it ends with a brilliant coda.
Thank you.
I just wanted to say thank you all so much for coming. We have a tiny little encore, if that's okay with you guys. I think you'll recognize it.
Thank you.